analyzing and reviewing data is an effective way of cutting down on lap times. We're here with Mike of Innovative Tuning and the LYFE Motorsport GT-R to get some more insight into using data for driver development. So Mike, naturally if we're reviewing data, we're going to need a fair amount of sensors and some way of logging that data. But what are the critical metrics that we're actually looking at when we're reviewing driver inputs and so forth?
Sure, yeah, absolutely. So in this particular case, we have a MoTeC ECU and dash. And on the dash, I am logging some engine parameters, but I've really focused my logging efforts on the dash, on driver development and vehicle development. So suspension pots for the suspension. I've got yaw sensor, G-sensor external to the dash just to be in a better location. I've got steering angle so I can see what the driver's hands are doing without having to have in-car video. Sometimes it's just not possible. Other than that, I like to have front and rear brake pressure, which I do on this particular vehicle, because it's a really good indicator of braking effort versus the potential that's being left on the table. Other than that, I'd love to have as much data as I can get, but GPS to see where the car is on the track to help correct line and those other items are a good place to start, just along with throttle angle.
So once we have that data, we can look at the traces and so forth. If we're analyzing the performance of one driver, what are we looking for in the data to understand where the room for improvement is?
Sure. So if it's a situation where we have data from a really good driver in this particular car on this particular track, it's really easy to look at areas of gains and loss and see what they're doing differently in a very specific fashion. If we only have one driver at the track, we don't have historical data to fall back on, then it's a little bit more open to interpretation. And in that particular instance, you can compare what's happening in certain corners to others. For example, you know, this particular corner, we're holding 1.5 lateral G, but over here, we're only at 1G. I can usually tell the driver, hey, unless you can explain to me why there's something on this part of the track that's dirty or something like that, we can probably corner at a similar pace to what we're doing on this other area, load the car up in similar fashion and expect it to have grip. So there's areas like that. Same thing with braking. You know, if I see they're running 1,700 pounds of front brake pressure coming down the main straight, but in other areas of the track, not even hitting 1,000, just ask them, hey, you know, you're braking really well on the straight. What's going on in these other areas?
Makes sense. So when we've identified those areas, then what's the process look like to relay that to the driver? If you've got 20 different areas they could improve, I'm sure that would be somewhat overwhelming.
Yeah, absolutely. And that really comes down to the level of the driver. So I find more novice drivers can usually accept about 2 or 3 points of correction per session, where a pro driver or a really skilled amateur driver can take quite a lot. So from yesterday to today, we dropped about 2 seconds in our car with Cole driving it. Really good driver. And I gave him about 3 pages of feedback. And he took it mostly to heart. I'd say at least half of it, you know, got put on the track on the first lap out. So I was really happy with that. And, you know, then we'll work from there. But, you know, I have an amateur driver. We have Jeremiah from Donut Media in the car as well this weekend. And he hasn't had as much time in that car. In fact, this is his first time in the car. He's never been to this track. And he hasn't driven a really high horsepower time attack car with downforce and such. So he's got experience in the car. He has car control skills. But there's a lot of things that he just hasn't had time for yet. So in his particular instance, most of the feedback was really consistent over the course of the lap. So a lot of it would come down to, you know, Cole's coming off the throttle deeper into the corner. He's getting on the brakes harder. And those are some really consistent differences I see between maybe even a pro driver, maybe even again a really skilled amateur driver, and then someone who just hasn't had as much seat time.
That makes a lot of sense. So actually, the method of overlaying that in the software, what does that look like? And how do you highlight those different areas?
Yeah, absolutely. So the MoTeC i2 software, or i2 Pro in particular, is what I end up using. And when I'm overlaying data, what I do is I like to view the trace based on feet in terms of distance around the track rather than time. So sometimes if you're just looking at a single lap from a single driver, your x-axis for all your strip charts is going to be time in seconds. But when I'm overlaying, I like to use feet, and simply because that way the two vehicles are overlaid in terms of their position on the track. So if I want to see, you know, at what point on the track each driver turns into a corner and one driver's 5 seconds faster than the other, you know, if we lined it up by time, I wouldn't be looking at the same point in the corner. So that's how I do that when we're doing an overlay. And then MoTeC will generate a lap gain or loss. So effectively, it's done that work for me as long as you set up the dash to log it. So I can show the driver, you know, between here and here, you've lost 0.2 to this other car. And that certainly speeds up the process. I can also graph the gain or loss as a line and see, you know, here the loss was really steep. In this other area, it's kind of flat. So you actually did really good there. So it's just kind of another visual point of reference for how they're doing.
So that would help you decide maybe where the key points you need to focus are on, where the biggest differences are.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's actually what I just did with Jeremiah.
So how do you manage the different expectations between a pro driver and amateur driver, and how is that factored into relaying that information to them?
Yeah, so with Coles in the car, our more experienced driver, we're really trying to maximize the performance of him and the car. We want to get everything out of it. So when I give him a correction, I'm trying to tell him how I think he can get everything out of the car. And then when I talk to Jeremiah, it's more about kind of inching his way forward, right? Making progress every session, getting his lap closer to the more experienced driver's lap. We don't want to try to have him, or really anybody, take a giant leap forward all at once. It's usually how you get into trouble. So incremental improvements each time. So we talked about, you know, fewer talking points, but also not how to get fully from A to B, but how to get maybe a quarter of the way there each time.
So naturally, every different driver, be it a different ability level or just driving style, how do we distinguish between when we need to make a setup change to the vehicle or something about the vehicle is just not right for that driver and when the driver needs to make a change?
Yeah, absolutely. In this particular case, we have our more experienced driver really trying to break some records, do as best as we possibly can in this competition. And he's looking really strong. We're right now third overall, broken the R35 record. So really excited about that. For him, I want to optimize the car. I want to optimize his driving. We're going to focus on him. For our second driver, he's getting great seat time. He's making a lot of progress. But if there's a particular change that's only going to suit him temporarily, it wouldn't really make sense to compromise the more experienced driver in this instance. But there's certainly ways that I can help them kind of work around parts of the setup that they feel are not quite what they're used to. And in this particular instance, the vehicle has a little bit of understeer that is in the setup, which our more experienced driver is used to overcoming from mid-corner to exit by getting on the throttle early and rotating it with power by breaking the back end loose, which is a pretty aggressive technique and not something everybody's comfortable with. But basically, helping the amateur driver just back off a little bit, allow the car to turn on its own, just offering those little bit of differences just to help him get through with the way the car is, yeah.
And where, in general, with your experience, would you say the most common differences between a pro-level driver and a more amateur driver would be?
Sure. I would say the pro driver's faster. Yeah. So more specifically, what we see a lot of is a little bit higher corner speed, a little bit higher lateral G as a result of that. But the bigger differences are the little nuances of where they come off the throttle, you know, going into each corner and how hard they get on the brake, right? And it's that little gap in the overlap between the release of the throttle and the application of the brake, and they really add up. So this particular vehicle makes about 1300 horsepower. And if the pro driver is accelerating for another 100 feet, that might be another 10 miles an hour. You know, we're on a 200 horsepower, maybe like a touring car, maybe it doesn't make much difference. But in time attack, when you have all that power, it makes all the difference in the world.
Thanks for that. That's some great insight into the use of data logging for driver development, but also some of the key differences between a pro-level driver and a more amateur driver. So if anyone wants to keep up to date with what's happening with the LYFE Motorsport GT-R or yourself with Innovative Tuning, where are they best to do so?
Sure. So LYFE Motorsport is LYFE Motorsport. And then I'm Innovative Tuning and innovativetuning.com or Innovative Tuning on Instagram.
Perfect. Thanks for your time.
Yeah, thank you.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.